Is that fun today? You guys gonna have fun? I love to have fun, so let's have fun today as we share the word. Today I'm gonna share with you about unstoppable giving. And if you have your notes, take that out. I'm gonna read a portion of scripture today from Luke 7, verse 36. When one of the Pharisees invited Jesus to have dinner with him, he went to the Pharisee's house and reclined at the table. A woman in that town who lived a sinful life learned that Jesus was eating at the Pharisee's house. So she came there with an alabaster jar of perfume. As she stood behind him, Jesus, at his feet, weeping, she began to wet his feet with her tears. Then she wiped them with her hair, kissed them, and poured perfume on them. So you can just imagine the story of this woman coming before Jesus, weeping and crying. And in order for her to wet his feet with her tears, I mean, she must have been crying, sobbing, coming before the Lord. And as you can see here, it's such a beautiful sight of her love for God. And I'm going to read further in the story in verse 39. It says, when a Pharisee, his name was Simon, when he invited Jesus to come over his house, when he saw this, this is what he said. He thought in his mind. He said, surely this man Jesus is a prophet. He should know what kind of woman this is that's kissing his feet. I mean, she's a sinful woman. And back then when they said she was a sinful woman, it meant that she was a prostitute. So here Simon already is judging Jesus and the woman and what's happening. Well, Jesus heard his thoughts. And this is what he said to Simon. Simon, I have something to tell you. I have a story to tell you. You see, he was setting him up for a lesson to this story. And Simon said, okay, tell me, teacher. Well, Jesus told this story. He said, two people owed money to a certain moneylender. One owed him 500 denarii. One owed him 50. And back then, a denarii was like a coin they used. And every a day's wage would be one denarii. So can you imagine, this one guy had 500 denarii that he had to own, this other guy 50 denarii. And so Jesus continued his story. He said, well, neither of the men had money to pay the guy back. So the moneylender forgave both their debts. Now, Jesus asked Simon, which one of the two would love him more? And so Simon thought about that for a while, and he said, well, I guess the one that owed him more, right? And Jesus says, you got that correct. And here Jesus said, he turned to the woman, and he said, Simon, do you see this woman? And Simon's probably thinking, yes, I see her. But Jesus said, no, do you really see the heart of this woman? He said, I came into your house. You did not give me any water for my feet. But she wet my feet with her tears and wiped them with her hair. You see, the traditions back then is when you invite a guest over to your house, you would wash their feet. But Simon did not do that. He told the man, well, you did not even give me a kiss. And back then they would kiss him on the cheek to greet their guests. He said, but this woman, from the time I entered, had not stopped kissing my feet. And you did not even put oil on my head, anointed me, right, with oil. But she, this woman, poured perfume on my feet. Wow, it's amazing. And this is what Jesus concluded his story with. He said, for this reason I say unto you, her sins, which are many, have been forgiven. For she loved much, but he who is forgiven little, loves little. Then he said to that woman, your sins have been forgiven. What a powerful story as we see this woman with the alabaster box coming before Jesus. And back then, alabaster was a perfume, very costly. And scholars say that in her box of alabaster perfume, it was worth a year's wages. It was a lot of money that she openly and willingly gave to Jesus, broke open her box, and put it all, anointed his feet. So that was a huge sacrifice of cost to her. But here we see Simon the Pharisee, very self-righteous, religious person. And back then, Pharisees were looked upon as holy men. you know, they would teach the word of God to the people, so people looked to them. And so a lot of times in the word you would read that Pharisees, they kept an outward look of holiness. They were fair to see. They looked great on the outside, but a lot of them were very cold-hearted on the inside. And you can see just how he thought about Jesus. He judged Jesus, probably judged a woman for what she's done. But I want us to focus here that Jesus said to the woman, her sins were forgiven because she loved much. But he, referring to Simon the Pharisee, he who is forgiven little, loves little. I would fair to say that Simon the Pharisee thought he didn't have much sins and he was close to being perfect, right? And so with that, thinking, I'm all good, you could see just how little love he gave it, he showed. But this woman, you see the amount of love. She gave more than enough to Jesus, where the Pharisee just gave just a little, just enough. She gave more than enough because it showed how much she was forgiven. And I want to show you this illustration. To the degree that you feel like you've been forgiven little, and this is like Simon the Pharisee, well, that's how much you love. Not very much, right? There's no thankful heart. I just, okay, well, you know, yeah, God forgave me, but, you know, I'm all good and all that. But if we see the woman, right, whose sinful past, she was a prostitute. She had a hard past. She felt received the forgiveness of God, Jesus. So with that, she was forgiven so much. Check that out. That's how much she loved. That's how much she loved back. And that's what God looks at. I've given you all, the Lord said. I've given you everything. How much will you love me and give me back in return? This woman just gave everything. She didn't care what people would say, what they were talking about. She didn't care how it would look. In fact, Jesus and her had this beautiful scene together. And even Jesus wasn't embarrassed by that. He said, oh, let her come. Let her love on me. And God says, don't despise the past you've come from. A lot of times people come to me and say, oh, Pastor, you don't know all the things that I've done in my life. I said, but Jesus forgave you, right? Yeah. Well, with the degree that you have been forgiven, wow, I see people in our church, they just full on love God. They full on give to others and to people. I'm like, wow, what has God forgiven you of? And they share with me their story after story of what God has done for them. Don't despise anything that brings you to your knees, your past that God has brought you out of. God's going to use it to propel you to be a great giver in his kingdom. Amen? Amen? Amen. And so we can glean so much truth from this scripture. It's amazing. And to see the love that this woman had for Jesus. You know, when it comes to giving, I like to, you know, look at people and their lives, and I see struggles in Christians and non-Christians alike. But many of us struggle with giving, right? How many of you? We struggle with giving a lot of times, and we're human. Especially Christians giving their whole lives and heart to the Lord. And what I have to remember is that we are all sinners, saved by grace. The Bible says, for all our sin comes short of the glory of God. And so with sin comes a lot of self-centeredness and selfishness. You can see it in a baby that's born, right? Everything is, I'm hungry, I'm tired, hold me, you know, change me. It's just all about me. But as we come to know Christ and as we mature in him, we should see that less and less. It should be not much as what about me, but or what do you want? How can I be a blessing to you, or how can I be a blessing to others? The focus is less on self and more to others. The Lord says in his word, he says, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. That requires a lot of giving. And God is challenging us today to be givers of all that he has done for us. And it's not so much in money. Money is one avenue that we can give, but it's in our time. How do you spend your time every day? How do you spend, use your talents, the skills, the gifts that God has given you? The knowledge that you bring forth to the church and to God, are you using it for him? And our treasures, our material wealth, our money, all of these things, God is challenging us. Can you be a person of unstoppable giving and give back to me. You know, there's an old story of a dad who one morning he gave his son 2 quarters. And he said, son, because we're on our way to church and you're going to Sunday school, as we go to church, I want you to give one of the quarters as an offering, and the other quarter, you can buy some ice cream with it. Well, obviously, this store is really old because you can buy ice cream, right, with a quarter. But the son was so happy. He said, oh, thanks, Dad. So as they're walking to church that morning, the son dropped one of the quarters and it rolled down the drain. The son looked down the drain and the quarter that went down there, he looked up to God and he said, sorry, Dad, there goes your quarter. Isn't it sometimes like us? Okay, yeah, I know Pastor Kent's been preaching on tithing. I want to give. Oh, I can't wait for the next paycheck. Payday's coming up soon. Oh, no, my car broke down. Oh, car repairs. Oh, sorry, God, there goes your tithe. Oh, what about that sale at Penny's, you know? There's a 2-for-1 sale. You know, I got to get my work clothes and things like that. Sorry, God, I'll tithe next time, right? And so the Bible says, where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. It's attached. So check out your pocketbook. Look at your checkbook. Look and see where is your money going. Look at your planner and say, where's my time going? Look at all that. And I challenge all those that are in my ministry, my leaders, where's your focus is going? Where's your treasure? Where's your time and attention, your giftings? There you will see your heart. May it be that all that we give our time to, that Jesus is the center of all that we do. It's a challenge for all of us as believers to do that. Amen? Amen. So let's evaluate if we have a giving heart. And this is not with money. This can be other areas. And so I'm going to ask you some questions, and you can evaluate where you are at. Number one, do you offer to help your spouse, or your children, if you're a child, your parents are on the house? Or do you try to stay busy when we don't need to, right? You see your mom needing help or, you know, your spouse, and it's like, oh, I'm busy, right? Well, how about this? Do you willingly give up the last piece of your dessert? Can't do that. That's why I'm so skinny anytime. Watching TV, your TV show for someone else to watch what they want, Pastor Bab. I'm not pointing fingers, but do we ask questions and listen attentively in conversation, or do we impatiently wish they quit talking so we can make our comment or tell our story? Don't you do that? Like someone's talking and you're like formulating what to say. Oh, I just wanna. Well, we don't just say, you know, the gift of listening is huge, especially as parents. You know, you had a long day at work, you're tired, your kids come home. It's their time for you to listen. How was your day? I always ask my kids that. How was your day in school? How's it going? What did you learn today? I take that time. It's a regular ritual with me and my kids. That gift of listening speaks volumes to the kids that you love and you care for them. How about this? Do we try to say yes if needed to serve in church? Children's ministry. Okay. I'm a part of a children's ministry. To help somebody move, help repair a car, give someone a ride. Are we available and open? Do we look for opportunities to invite someone over for a meal? Or do we look for opportunity to go over somebody's house for a meal? I know you, life group, that life group, have you? Holla, I'm there. Right? Do we take interest in children in general? Offer help to someone older or disabled when no one sees? You know, because not because I'm a children's pastor, but because God has really formulated my heart with kids. I remember being a kid. You guys all remember being a kid? Yes. You're looking up and all these adults are around you. Sometimes they just ignore you. So at church, I make it a point, whenever I see any child that I know or not know, I always acknowledge them. Good morning, how are you doing? What's your name? Oh, nice to have you. Hey, how are you? How's it going? And if I know the kid, I'm like, how are you doing? How's school? I make the time to acknowledge them. Because that's what Christ did. He acknowledged the children. They're people too, you know. And they care. And I see when I do acknowledge them, oh, you should see their faces light up. Oh, Pastor Reese, she knows I exist, you know. I'm like, because I'm your pastor. I love you. And we are all family, Ohana, right? So that's your kids too. So can you hug a kid and love them when you see them around? The teens, I know. Sometimes they act like, you know, they don't need you. But they really enjoy the hugs. Don't you, teens out there? So giving your time, your talents, and treasures, God wants to use us to bless those around us. So in your notes, there are many blessings that comes with your unstoppable giving. That comes from a loving, faithful, and willing heart. So in your first bullet point, why? Because it gets God's attention. 2 Chronicles 16:9 says, the eyes of the Lord search the whole earth in order to strengthen those whose hearts are fully committed to him. You know that God is watching you? He sees. He's everywhere. He's omnipresent. He's all-knowing. He is everywhere, and he sees. He sees the good that you do and sees the bad, the wrong choices that you make. You know, from time to time, every so often, I hear God saying, I'm watching you, Lisa. And if I'm not doing well, you know, in life, or I'm just kind of, I don't know, making some wrong choices, I'm just like, oh, you see me. I'm sorry, God. I don't think he says it to convict me or to harsh me, but he wants me to realize that he's involved in every part of my life, every area. So when I feel that, I'm just like, oh, I'm sorry. I know I'm messing up. I'm treating people with disrespect or different things like that, Lord. I'm sorry. Forgive me. He said, yeah, hold your head up. I just love you. And I want better from you. You're my daughter. And then when he says, I love you, my eyes are on you, I'm watching you, and I'm doing well and just serving him, I feel like my daddy, God, is proud of me. You know, I grew up not having a father. My father died when I was 6 months old. He was taken away from our family. And so I never had a father saying, I love you, Lisa. I'm proud of you. So when I hear the voice of God, he says, I love you. I'm so proud of you. I'm like, thank you, God. So when I'm doing something good, I'm like, watch me now, Lord. Look what I'm doing. I do it. Offer him that audience of one. Next, it's unstoppable giving is ultimately done unto the Lord. Did you know that? Colossians 3:23 says, whatever you do, do it enthusiastically as something done for the Lord and not for men. This scripture is great as a great attitude check. Because I know we all go through times. Okay, work again. Oh, the drag, you know, you drag yourself in, you know. But may I encourage you, as a Christian, and if people know you're a Christian at work, may you do things enthusiastically. You may not feel it, but if they see you just like, I'll turn that project in. Then they're just like, but you're a Christian, dude. Right? What's up? Yeah. It should, Lord, give me strength. Lord, help me to be a witness for you. Right? We're not perfect, and we all go through things, but it should be an encouragement to be that light for the Lord. Amen? Ultimately, it's done unto the Lord. And what I love about the scripture is we spend so much time worrying about what other people think. I want to get their approval, right? I want the applause of men. I want to make a good first impression of people. That's great. But may I encourage you, let your focus not be on people. Lift your eyes and say, I want to do it for you. Because you're going to do it where there's people or not, right? Especially in the secret place, serve. I want to call us like secret agents, where we do stuff and nobody sees, or you bless people. I like to give things anonymously to people. I've done it through my walk with the Lord, and no one knows, only God. And I just get a thrill of that. And so I do things as unto the Lord and not to men. And I feel like a word for some of you here is that you've been working hard. I don't know if it's on your job, home, at church, and you feel like, no one appreciates you. I'm going to thank you. I think I'm going to quit this job, or I want to get out of ministry, or get out of this family. You know, that's very real. And the Lord says, I see you. I see your heart. I see your heart of giving, and I'm going to bless you. Do it unto me, the Lord says. You watch. and watch me pour out blessings upon you, amen? So do it unto the Lord, especially moms out there. I mean, as I'm speaking myself as a mom of two sons, I mean, we're just giving, giving, giving. And I look at my husband, I want to acknowledge my husband. My husband is a dad and a husband, and he's a senior pastor. And recently I had a talk with him. I said, Ted, you are such a blessing to our church, to our family. Thank you so much. He goes beyond. And as a wife and mom, I mean, I do a lot of home, but he does so much more. We call him, we have a name for him, he's the replenisher. Because you're always like, I'm going to toilet paper. Why are you planning still, you know, in the container? He does that. He replenishes just everything, all the canned goods, the detergent. He goes shopping. He does most of the shopping. Isn't that a blessing? So I'm like, oh, you're such a blessing. So I just wanted to honor my husband and say thank you for all that. Giving comes with a cost. It is not always convenient. Oh yeah, I want to be an unstoppable giver. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Oh, it's going to cost me that much? I don't know if I can give that much, right? You go through that. Well, the story to share with you, you know, I was born and raised in Hawaii, and so one day I was driving home from work, it was in the night, in the evening. And it was from Bible study. So I was on a spiritual high, you know, just like, ah, Lord, I want to live for you, I want to be alive, you know. And so as I was coming home, I lived in Waipio Gentry at the time, it's in Waipahu. So as I'm driving, it's raining, dark, and I see this car stalled on the side of the road with their hazard lights on. So I said, I don't know, this came out of my mouth. I just said, Lord, if it's a woman that's stranded by herself, I want to be a blessing and help her. So I'm driving, I look at the car, there's no one in the car. So I'm driving on, there I see someone walking in the dark, in the rain, and I look and it's a woman. So I drive, I go to the side of the road, and I say, you need a ride? And she's like, yeah, I would love a ride. So she gets into my car, and she said, just take me to the nearest phone. And that, it was so long ago, we didn't have cell phones, right? And she's like, just find me a place I can call my husband. I said, you know what, just take you home. Thinking that she lives around the corner. And so I'm like, so where do you live? Wahiwa. Schofield Barracks. Now for those of you who don't live in Hawaii, it's like if I was driving on the 250 and I live somewhere, right? My town center. And I picked someone up, I said, where do you live? And they said, North Aliante. Like 20, 30 miles, you know, from where I live. So that's how I felt. And I looked at her and I just smiled. I said, the Lord. And so I'm driving. The good thing is, she said, where'd you come from? I said, church. I go to church and I had a Bible study. I started witnessing to her. You know, she was real open to the Lord. Well, we finally get to her house and she gets her husband and they're ready to go. And she goes, oh, can you do me a really big favor? I said, sure. Well, she's like, I don't know where I left my car. I'm not familiar with that area. Can we follow you to my car? Can you take us to my car? And so we can get to that. And I just smiled. I said, it's so hard. So I'm like, okay, so they're following me, taking her to her car, and I'm driving, and I could just hear God in heaven. You know that God cracks up and laughs? I mean, I think he does, like, I just felt him laugh. And he said, you said you want to be a blessing. You're on the spiritual high, give yourself away. So you, and I was like, only when it's convenient, or if I get enough gas. And here, yeah. I'm like, oh, I'm sorry, God. And I said, wow, I was a blessing to that woman, right, Lord? He said, yeah. Would anyone have picked her up? I said, probably not. I could have been somebody's mom, right? Somebody's daughter, wife. And I was a blessing that day. And so, amen, right? God is good. God is so good. But he's funny. So after this message, I know you guys are like, yeah, Lord, I want to give. 9:7 says, each one must give as he has decided in his heart, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. Wow. He loves it when we give cheerfully. He checks the attitude of our heart. Oh, God, I just gave plenty tithes to you. But yeah, already, you know. But God's like, so? I mean, sometimes I feel like he's like, so? But if I'm like, Lord, I gave out of a good heart. Wow, that was a big gift. I felt compelled to bless you with finances or anything, material goods or whatever. And if your heart is right, God is pleased. But if it sucks, if your heart, if you just have a sucky attitude, then God's like, okay, that was our part. Thank you. That's it. That's all you get, you know? And so God challenges me, especially as a mom, to continue to give and give, right? A mother's work is never done. You're constantly, as a parent as well, constantly giving. So I just often I say, Lord, I'm not as cheerful today. I'm giving, you know? Sometimes it can suck being a parent, because it's hard. And sometimes I have to tell my kids, see, thank you. Wasn't this a good meal? I worked really hard. Say thank you. And the boy's like, thank you. And I'm like, twist our arm. Thank you. but this is something I was going to share with you, because I teach the noon service, the kids' ministry, the children's church. So I was asking them this question. I said, how do you know your parents love you? Can you share with me? How do you know? And I thought they'd say, oh, because they give me hugs and they tell me I love you. You know, I thought they would share stuff like that. And most of my class is boys. So these are what the boys are saying. They said, I know my mom and dad loves me because they give me food to eat. That's man, right? Food. They're happy. I mean, you know. What else? Oh, because they buy me clothes and nice Jordan shoes, you know. Oh, they take me to my sports games and, you know, they help me with my homework. So cute, yeah? It was like so cute. And I was like, wow, Lord, it's just like you and me in our relationship with the Lord. I know you love me. I feel and sense your love and your word says that, but I see that in how you provide for me, right? I see how you give to me friends and family and loved ones and not only material goods, but a house to live in and just blessings. That's how I know God loves me, because of what he has given to me. Amen? So I want to challenge you parents, sometimes when you don't feel appreciated, your kids really love you. They appreciate all that you do, and especially the Lord who loves you. Amen? So when we're fixing our problems and avoiding things, and we're like, I'm tired of giving, I'm tired of going through my own stress. You know, like sometimes I feel that way, I will be honest. I'm like, can't take the boys and go to McDonald's. Because I'm just tired of cooking. Every day you have to think of what you're going to make, right? Right, women? Like, I'm out of my business. So I'm in, you know, spam. I mean, you know, but it's like, so I'm like, Lord. And so I'm like, okay, Lord, refresh me as a mom. Refresh me, pray. Refresh me as a dad, as a wife, as a worker, as a leader, as a volunteer. Refresh me. And Lord, I want to just give back and be a blessing. So every day, this is what I pray. Lord, when I wake up, make me a blessing. Just send people to me who are in need. And you know, I get these calls out of them, hey, can you help me? You know, can I meet with you? Can you? I'm like, sure. It's my way of giving back to the Lord. And God desires that cheerfulness, that heart of giving. So your unstoppable giving will also be reciprocated back to you. That's a fancy way of saying what you give is what you will receive. It will be returned to you. The Bible says you will reap that which you sow. And that's a good and bad thing. There's blessings when you sow blessings and you give to others. But there's consequences if you do that. People call it karma, you know? And I really believe in this principle, and that's why I'm a firm believer in giving, even in the smallest of things. And when God starts to speak to me, he used to send a text to someone, encourage them. Why don't you send a card or just shoot up a prayer for them? He said, why don't you clean out your closet, you have all the clothes that you would use. Why don't you go bless the rescue mission? Go and bless someone in church. But God is always having me to give, because he's a giving God. But we have to listen, right? be attentive to his voice. He's always saying, be a blessing and give and give. And you watch, when you give, it will be given back to you. Luke 6:38 says, give and you will receive. Your gift will return to you in full, pressed down, shaken together to make room for more, running over and poured into your lap. The amount you give will determine the amount you get back. Everybody say, give. And you will receive. Do you believe that?
Yes.
If you truly believe that, you will be one of the biggest givers that in this city of Las Vegas. Christians should be the biggest givers. Well, not only money, in every way. Being thoughtful, kind, respectful. On the road, driving, somebody cuts you off, right? You don't want to just chase them down and cut them off. Yeah, I've seen that, right? How you don't treat others the way they treat you. You treat others how God treats you. How has God been treating you? He's a God of love, forgiveness, grace. He provides for you. That's what you should give back. Not, oh, if this person did that to me, I'm just going to give him back what he deserves in a negative way. Right? Well, we do that because we're human. And God's like, no, you bless them back. You give it. You watch. It will be given back to you. Amen?
Amen.
And lastly, your unstoppable giving will be remembered and rewarded. The scripture in Mark 14:9 talks about the woman in the alabaster box. And this story was repeated four times in the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. And Jesus said this to the woman with the alabaster box. He said, truly I tell you, wherever the gospel is preached throughout the world, what she has done will also be told in memory of her. So check this out. We're talking about her now. In memory of what she did. Her heart of unstoppable giving. You know that alabaster box of perfume? It's 1 year's wage. Would you spend 1 year's wage on somebody's feet? If someone said, yeah, go give all your money and pour it out on this person. Wow. I mean, if you put it in that kind of context, maybe 30, 40,000 a year, you would give all of that? Wow. So you think, wow, this woman. And so Jesus was probably blown away by her act of unstoppable giving. She gave everything. And so he said, with that, all that she's done, it will be remembered throughout the whole world. It was like, he said, let's just make a holiday for the woman with the alabaster box, right? We do holidays to remember people, right? That's what he did. He memorialized her for unstoppable giving. Jeremiah 17:10, this is the Lord speaking, and he says, I search the heart and examine the mind to reward each person according to their conduct, according to what their deeds have done. You see, you know that God does not have Alzheimer's or dementia. And forget, God, I give you, and I must bless you. It's like, don't worry, beef curry. I get him. I have my book. I remember all the deeds. I gotta wake you guys up because you're all tired. Giving. He sees, he looks, and as you give, he will reward you. He'll remember what that should encourage us. Because I know a lot of you thinking, nobody sees, nobody appreciates. God sees. And he's gonna reward you and bless you that. It's amazing. So let me ask you a question. Do you know that the degree of giving, your giving, is directly related to how much you love someone? So just think of something that you love. Your family member or whatever, someone close to you. And look at the degree as you give, how much you love that person. Right? Do we give as much to a stranger? Probably not. But to our husband, to our wives, to our kids, right? To our close friends, wow, we say we love them, you see people giving, right? And so with that in mind, we want to see that if we say, I love you, God, and I give my life with my heart away, then our giving should be proportional. It should be the same, right? You can say, I love you, God, but not give of your time, your talent, your treasures. Then what's going on? Why that disconnect? See, you can give, but not really love someone. You can just give stuff away. But if you say you love something or someone, there's going to be giving involved. It's just like in a marriage, right? When you first get married or first dating, oh, you get flowers and your attention and your time and call them, right? You're polite, you're considerate, you're giving your all. Well, what happens after you get married? Say, you're the giving. You've been married a long time. Okay. I've been married a long time and I'm gonna call from the bar, but nothing. No flowers. You forget my birthday. All this thing coming up, man. Please. That's right. What happened? If I would interview the man, you still love your wife. Of course I love her, but I don't know, sometimes I love golfing more, or football, or fishing, or, you know, my job. Well, what's going on, right? Do you love this person? Do you love this vision? Do you love God? He says, give. That's going to be the response. Check your heart of giving, and I encourage and challenge you. Don't let your love grow cold. And Jesus referred to this in Revelation 2:4. He said this to the church of Ephesus, I have this complaint against you. You don't love me or each other as you did at first. Look how far you've fallen. What he was saying was, you lost your first love. You've left your first love. And so this is his answer to what you do in that when your love grows cold. He says, turn back to me and do the works you did at first. So here you go, for all of you out there, especially for those in a relationship. Go back and say, yeah, I've kind of lost sight of this amazing relationship that God's given me, and I put other things first. I put my other loves, I got distracted, and I started to hold back that gift. And God says, turn to God, say, God, forgive me, I'm so sorry, I repent. Go to that loved one and say, I'm so sorry. I stopped giving and I just took you for granted. I want to start making things right again. Because we need to fast forward the tape. If you're feeling like there's a drift in your relationship, don't let it continue to drift. Continue to drift. Because if you fast forward the tape and you stop giving, you let your relationship drift, you fast forward it, you're not going to have a home to go to. You're not going to have a wife or a husband or kids to go to. Don't let it drift so far away that your relationship with God. And so I want to encourage you with that. You need to not take one another for granted and to recommit ourselves to our marriage, our relationships, our relationship with God, and continue to give out of a heart of freshness. So the question is, have you lost your joy of giving today? We all go through time to time of being tired. And I encourage you to just come back to the Lord. The Lord's speaking to you today. Say, God, I've lost that joy of giving. I stopped giving. Forgive me, Lord. Refresh me. The Bible says, they that wait on the Lord shall renew their strength, right? He will come and he will refresh in you. He will fill you up. Take time aside to just fill up and get replenished again so you can continue this marriage strong. It's not how you start a marriage. It's how you finish it. So finish strong. It's not how you start coming to Christ. Yeah, I accepted Christ. I want you guys to finish strong in him. And the key is giving. Giving out of a sacrificial heart of love and of thanksgiving to the Lord. Amen. So I want to encourage you, we're having that Weekend to Remember marriage conference, relationship conference. I want to encourage you guys to go. Well, oh, you know, I've been married a long time. She knows I love her. Right, honey? You know I love you, right? My husband and I are going 22 years of marriage, and we're going to the conference. So please go. I know. So I said, well, if I changed my mind, I would have told him, but he knows I love him, you know? It's just in the heart of giving. It's showing that you love. So second point, God's unstoppable giving came out of a heart of love for us. For John 3:16 says, for God so loved the world that, what did he do?
He gave
his only, one and only son, Jesus Christ, that whoever believes in him would not perish, but have everlasting life. That's how much God loves you and I. And he bankrupted heaven. He said, I'm going to just give my son. Would you give your only child to sinners? Someone we think wasn't going to deserve that. Oh, but God did that for us. And so every time, I've been serving the Lord for like 30 years. I got saved when I was 18. And I just have to renew my love walk with the Lord and what he's done for me. And how the Lord challenges me. He said, do you really love me? He said, serve, love, forgive, bless, be thoughtful and kind and considerate. That's how you can show that you love me. So Christ did that for us, so we must do it for other people. So then can we pray right now? I want to pray for you folks in this area of esophagogia. We thank you, Lord. Father, we thank you so much, Lord God, that you gave your son Jesus to die on the cross for us, Lord. Thank you for that woman with the alabaster box, Lord, that continued to give on no matter her past, no matter what people would have said to her. God, she continued to give with a heart of unstoppable giving. Lord, let her life be an example for all of us to follow. We love you, Lord, in Jesus' name.
Amen. Many stories in the Bible go unnoticed. For instance, the story of the woman and her alabaster box. Watch as the story unfolds.
Dive up to the
you for this woman that gave out of extravagance her love for you, Lord. We thank you, Lord, that her be an example to us of our love to you. We thank you, Lord. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your love, Lord. We thank you for giving your son Jesus for us, that we may live and have eternal life in you, Lord.